In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Today, my beloved, is the fourth Sunday of the blessed month of Abib. And the month of Abib is a month of service. The first Sunday was the mission of the 70 apostles. The second Sunday, Jesus set the model to be like a child. And he warned us as servants from having any offenses. The third Sunday, the apostles came and reported to the Lord what they did, and he showed them a model of service. He talked to people about the kingdom of God, then he healed their sickness, then he fed them, and there was a dialogue between the Lord and the disciples how to feed such big number of people. The fourth Sunday is a power of service. That's why the church begged for us the great miracle of raising Lazarus from dead, which we celebrate always Saturday before the entry to Jerusalem, to tell us that coming back or repenting is a kind of new life or experiencing resurrection. I want to ask a question at the beginning. Why the three synoptic gospels, they didn't mention the miracle of raising Lazarus, and it was a great miracle by all means. This was the end of the service and the beginning of the road to Golgotha. And only John, he mentioned it for a simple reason. During the writing of the three synoptic gospels, Lazarus was still alive. So they didn't want to embarrass him by this. But the fourth gospel was written after, because he lived for 40 years. So he died around year 75 or after that, or 80. So it was almost 10 years after that. I want to focus on something very important in this miracle. What Jesus announced to Martha. And this is, I believe, was the core of this gospel. When he said, I am the resurrection and the life. When Jesus talked to Martha, she was in sorrow. She was weeping. And this is what death caused to any human being. We feel we are detached from people we love. We feel sorrow, and we keep weeping for this. But the Lord didn't tell her, don't weep like the widow of Nain. But he approached her in something very important, and we focus on this during the Holy Pascha week. I am the resurrection and the life. Martha told by the Pharisees that everybody will arise at the last day. And this is what most of the Jewish people, they believe, not except the Sadducees. So when he announced, I am the resurrection and the life, he was not talking only about Lazarus. He was talking about two. And he said it very clear to her. I want to just get back a little bit. Jesus told her, your brother will rise again. And she responded to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last days. But Jesus was not talking about the resurrection of the last days. However, what he's going to say doesn't change the resurrection at the last day. He was talking about the power of life in him. And here we connect between resurrection and the eternal life and incarnation. He is born from the Holy Virgin Mary without sin, and he was the Son of God and became also Son of Man. As a Son of God, his body carries all the divinity. That's why The fathers, they like to say, the biggest miracle Jesus did is what? What do you think the greatest miracle Jesus did? Lazarus? No. His resurrection. His resurrection. Because anybody, any person, he was raised from the dead, somebody else rose him. But Jesus, by himself, he defeated death. And we like always to sing this. By this, he defeated death. By accepting death to himself, he defeated death. How he can defeat death? Anybody can help me? Can help me? How he defeated death? Huh? By the life in him. Because the devil cannot take away his life. The life in him, through his divinity, gave him this power to triumph over death, to defeat death. And this is the greatest miracle to prove his divinity, that he rose by himself. But he wanna extend this power of resurrection from him to us. How? By taking our body. He took exactly our body from the Holy Virgin Mary. And we believe that Jesus is perfect in divinity and perfect in humanity. That's why in his humanity, he accepted death like any person. But if he was not crucified, he will not die because of his divinity. That's why he has to be crucified. And we explained before why crucified, to be in air and to open his arms to defeat the authority of the devil, who is the prince of the world of air, and to open his arms to everybody. But my point is that he announced for us the resurrection on him. And here, if I notice what the church planned for me, I will see that I am enjoying the resurrection and the life before the last day. How? What we used to do in baptism? Huh? We die for ourselves and rise with the Lord. So the one who is coming out of the baptismal font is united with the resurrection of the Lord. So now you are not just bodies like any person. Your bodies joined this glory. So you will experience two types of resurrection. The resurrection you got in baptism and the last day's resurrection, which is still there. What I'm saying is explained in the Bible in so many verses. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? So here he is telling her, I'm not here for Lazarus alone. I am here for Lazarus and for you. For Lazarus and for you. The one who died will have life on him. And the one who didn't die will have life on him. That's why I want to get this feeling into your heart. I am resurrected with the Lord. I am different. I have the power of resurrection in my life. That's why there is no death for a man who lives with Christ. How can a person die while holding the resurrection? But if I give up the resurrection, what will happen? I will die. And this is represented on the if I sin or repent. If I sin, I'm separating myself from life. If I repent, I'm getting back into life. Now I think it is clear. The earthly body now holds the light and the eternal life from our spiritual eyes. But as soon as we get rid of it, we see light and life Christ has corrected the thoughts of Martha regarding the resurrection. As I told you, she's taught that it is only for the last day. When he said, I am the resurrection and the life, this is a fact of salvation and not just a statement of faith. And when I say a fact of salvation means, if I live the life of repentance, I'm abiding by the Lord, and I have his life in me. If I separate myself from the Lord, I am separated from his life, and I'm dead. And the very simple example I use is any electrical equipment, this iPad, this anything. If you have the greatest one without hooking it into electricity, what will do? Piece of antique. We are the same. If you are not hooked to God, you will not have anything. St. Paul elaborated on this when he said, so when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. By understanding what I explained, we can understand what St. Paul said. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And by saying, I'm the resurrection and the life, this means he lives on us. He is inside us. St. Paul also said in his epistle to the Romans, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And here this will take me to another important point. If I repent, how do I feel about the day of judgment? If I follow what St. Macarius said, my brother, judge yourself before they judge you. So the one who is repenting and showing, returning to God always, he doesn't get afraid from the day of judgment. Why? Because he judged himself, he offered repentance, and he has Jesus' life on him. And this is what he made it clear, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So this is one indicator St. Paul said, to know if you are abiding on Jesus' resurrection or you are separated. Do you walk according to the flesh or according to the Spirit? We know that we have passed death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. This is the second parameter. I'm giving you parameters to discover if you are alive or you're dead. The first one is you walk according to the Spirit versus you walk according to the flesh. The second one, if you love the brethren, and this is definitely from Epistle of St. John. If you love the brethren, you have life. If you don't love the brethren, you don't have life. St. Paul said also, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Third criteria, third indicator for having the life of Christ. My mind is in heaven. So to just remind you, first is walk according to the Spirit versus walk according to the flesh. Second is love the brethren versus hate the brethren. Third one is my mind is in heaven versus my mind is totally occupied and busy here on earth. Do you think, my beloved, about how it's going to be in eternity? How's it going to be when you are with God? Are you busy with this? Or you are always busy with what you're going to eat, where we are going to go, what we are going to plan, what we are... That's why when Jesus appears, we will appear with him in glory because our life is connected to him. In the Gospel of St. John, the Lord said also, most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment but has passed from death into life. And this is which number one, number what? Four. Who hears my word and believes in him. So by listening to the word of God, if you close your gospel, you don't know where is your Bible, then you are not complying with this. If you have an open Bible, and when you read, don't say, oh, this verse is for this person. He's talking about him. No, I want each verse to be about you. About you. And you believe in him. So the four measures to know that you are alive and you abide on Jesus' resurrection. Number one is walk according to the flesh. Walk according to the Spirit. Number two, love the brethren. Number three, your mind is set in heaven. Number four, his word and believe in him. Okay, I will add number five, which we're gonna practice now. Anybody can tell me which one? After Abuna finishes the prayer for the institution of the sacrament, you recite a hymn all together. Amen, amen, amen. Can you remember the rest of it? Can you say it, please? Amen, amen. You're not going to say it when I pray now? I want to hear loud voice. Come on. Amen. Truly, I feel I'm in heaven. We say this, we recite this hymn, after Abuna will say, who eats of this body and this bread, what you're going to have? Eternal life. That's why when we confess and proclaim the resurrection of the Lord, we confess and proclaim our resurrection in the Lord. Shall I repeat this again? Because he said, I am the resurrection and the life. But if he didn't die or didn't rose from the dead, then there is no life. But because of his resurrection is the guarantee for my resurrection. By faith, I have his resurrection now. That's why now the people who departed already, they look at us and they want us to understand the glory waiting for us in heaven. When somebody we love departs, we feel sorrow and pain, weep. But if we think that this person, he practiced the resurrection in full capacity, because we have resurrection now, but we rise and fall. But the people who take off the body, those people are in continuous happiness and joy of the resurrection. So who should cry for the other? We cry for them, but actually they cry for us to be godly. So the communion, partaking from the communion, is giving you life, because he said this, my flesh is meat indeed, and my body is drink indeed. Who eats my body and drinks my blood? Huh? He expressed it in two ways. Will have eternal life, and explain another way, he will steadfast in me. And he, I can change it into steadfast in life. This means resurrection. I don't want to take longer than this, but I want to ask each one of you. You have the switch between life and death. You have the switch between abiding to the Lord and being godly and enjoying the resurrection and have the power to say no to death. And by abiding in the Lord, you can defeat death like what Jesus did. And you have also the free will to choose to separate yourself from God, because sin separates us from God. So here, I want to conclude with two words. Shall you tell me the five criteria for showing your life? Huh? Okay, we have 2 minutes. What are the five? Number one is walk in the Spirit. Number two, love the brethren. No. Louder, please. Number one is? Walk, yeah. Number two? Love the brethren. Number three, mind in heaven. Number four, listen to his words and believe in it. Number five, abide on him in communion, believing on his death and his resurrection. That's why, keep in mind, by repenting, you are getting back to life. Why? Because you are abiding in the Lord. That's why, in the litany of the gospel, we say you are our life and our resurrection. I want you to keep in mind, Jesus is my, can you repeat this after me? Jesus is my life and my resurrection. Did you hear this maybe thousands of times? Did you thought of it this way? Abide in the Lord, and you will have his life in you, and glory be to God forever. Amen.